dogs, buddy.
Anarchy for the UK is coming sometime. And maybe I give a wrong time, stop a traffic line. Your future dream is a shopping scheme, cause I wanna be anarchy in your city.
Anyway, the beginnings of punk.
Alright, I let him talk, go ahead.
Right, you let me talk. Yeah, in London last year, right, there was a pub scene. And you had various bands playing a lot of, you know, the pubs in London. A lot of people were having music in pubs, you know. Hope and Anchor, the Kensington, the Nashville. Jim, in or out, come on.
Go on. Tell them about punk, Mark.
The identification with to identify with something of their own.
No message. No kids have had a message for years.
How great the 50s were, how great the 60s were, you know, and we were all living off the 60s.
How everything related to the 60s.
Slamming the foot down in all that old crap that was going down, you know, like, you know, we needed identity of our own, you know, 1977.
No, this political angle ain't new. They've done it all before in that movie, yeah, Privilege, with Paul Jones.
Street Fighting Man by the Stones, you know, I mean, that was political, you know.
But the point is, we're just, you know, talking about youth again, singing songs about problems of everyday life.
Yeah,
people have just been singing songs about science fiction fantasy.
You know, I mean,
like
nobody, what relevance is like, oh, I love my baby, you know, and I shag my bird round the back street, you know, or what relevance is that today? There are problems, you know, which have been pushed underground for too long, which are today, you know, they have to be brought
people
up.
People ain't got time to think about the cosmos and the universe, you know,
yeah.
When they ain't got any money to live on.
Yeah.
The whole Western world's a big joke.
To go around, you know, you've got 50 pence, you know, to get a meal or something at the movies. It was totally boring, you know, after the hippie era, you know, when like everything was free there. You know, it was like you could live off that, you know, it was great. It was great to live off that. I used to live off that personally, you know. That scene, you know, that era. You know. But this is it, you know, and I just thought, well, the crap that was going down then, you know. One second. The crap that was going down then, you know, was like not relevant to me at all, you know. It was nothing to do with the way I felt, you know, so I thought, right, do it myself. You know. Consequently, you know, the band got together, you know. James Stevenson on guitar, Kerry Fortune on drums, Andy Koswoski, our manager, you know, Simon Vitesse on bass. You know, we just got together, we thought, right, let's change it. Let's do something. Was like originate one of the first bands ever to play the Roxy, you know, with other bands, you know, right? And he's very, very, very important to the music that's going down now. It's very hardcore, very political, as regards to like we have the single like Right to Work, you know, which is about, you know, millions of kids that leave school, you know, haven't got a job. The individual, really, the right for the individual to do their thing, you know, is what it's about, you know, the right to work.
When the punk rock business was starting up and groups wanted to play, they were rejected by everybody and everywhere. And so it was very difficult to get work for them. So the obvious thing was to try and do something yourself, which was equally as difficult because we have a lot of problems in London about licenses and drinking and playing loud music. So there's a lot of problems came up about the same time. See, I managed a group called The Damned and also managed a group called Generation X. When I worked with Generation X, I realized that there was a lot of problems that involved with who was getting work for these bands. So the easiest thing probably was to find a place yourself. This I did by finding a club called the Roxy Club. And I put on the band called Generation X, and it worked very well, which we knew it would. At the same time, a lot of new groups were coming and playing in London all the time. So they obviously contacted me to put on their groups to play in the club. But the club was on a very loose basis. I hired it every week, and very expensive too, because the man wasn't prepared to let me have the club, because he thought there was too much risk involved because of teenagers and drinking and drugs and loud music. So I had to pay a very high rent to compensate him. But it was worth it to me because we weren't so much interested in making money, but just to have some fun and have an outlet for this new energy which was growing all the time, especially the music and the clothes and the fashions, everything. So we had an understanding between us that the sort of thing we wanted to do. So it became an immediate success, and we didn't have to advertise because it wasn't necessary to bring people from the streets into the club, because we only wanted people in the club who were interested. If they were interested in the music and the clothes, they would come down naturally because of their friends would be involved in something. So it became a very exciting and central point to all the punk rock, because they had somewhere to create things, to mix with each other, to form new bands and exchange ideas. It stopped because it just got too much eventually. The money that was wanted from us, we couldn't afford to generate from the bands and from the people. But of course we still had the restraints of the outside world, which was high rents, and that they just wouldn't meet. And we couldn't, or we wouldn't put the prices up on the door, because we would be in the same capacity as the people who were in rock music before, where they were charging maybe £5, you know, to get to see a group, which we didn't want to do. We were only concerned with charging maybe £1 to see three groups.
Zu den aufregendsten Gruppen auf dem Live-Album vom Roxy Club zählen die X-Ray Specs.
Little girls should be seen and not heard.
Yeah! I write most things about plastic things and artificial things. You could say they're social comments, but they're slightly different to what anybody else is writing.
Do you like plastic?
I mean, it's there, isn't it? I mean, it's part of now. It's not a question whether I like it. It exists, and I just write about things like that in my immediate environment. Most people associate bondage with sexual bondage and things like that. That's probably why they get banned, because they think it's perverted, and you know, they think of whips and things like that, but it isn't really. It's about any form of slavery, and it's against that. It's saying no bondage up yours, you know, fuck off tonight. Well, that's that one, really. And then what was the other one? Was it identity? It's just about, that's sort of one of the current problems at the moment, is identity. You know, people to identify with something. Everybody's looking desperately to try and identify with one thing instead of themselves, and that's what that's about.
What?
I don't like art talking, you know, very much. That's why I write songs.
Eine Riesendemütigung für einen Engländer ist es, in einem Hochhaus ohne eigene Haustür zu leben. In einem derartigen Haus im Süden Londons wohnt Arturo Bessig, der 19-jährige Bassist der Lurkers, mit seinen Eltern. Die Lurkers bestehen seit ein paar Monaten und haben mit ihrer selbstverlegten Single Shadows großen Erfolg.
It's just, I've always liked energetic music, but it became really stagnant over the last 4 years, sort of the heavy metal groups, with long guitar solos and 20-minute numbers. And I know, I just like it because it's so accessible. You can get, it's really easy to understand because it's, you know, 2-minute numbers, and you get straight to the point with no mucking around. Not like someone like, I don't know, Led Zeppelin or Black Sabbath or whatever. It's really too long drawn out and go to sleep. I've fallen asleep at a Black Sabbath concert before. Even the volume couldn't keep me awake. I was just really bored. But punk is so much more energetic and to the point, you know.
There are some punk groups like The Clash with political and social statements. What do you think about it?
I think they're really good. I think they needed to be said. A lot of groups are just singing about love all the time. And that's always been done for years and years. No one's ever sung political songs before. And it's about time somebody did, because it affects everyone all the time. There's no doubt about it. You can't get away from politics. It affects every move you make. From drinking a pint of beer to buying a car or whatever. It's all to do with politics, which really stem from money. And the Clash can put political situations and aspects of politics into really a short space of time in 2 minute numbers and really get a point over about it. So I think it's really good that people are singing about politics.
How long are you playing now with Beth?
With the Lurkers?
No.
I've only been playing the bass since I've been with the Lurkers, which is about 4.5 months, 5 months. But I've mucked around just playing the guitar for about 5 years without ever doing anything. Just playing in my bedroom, you know, to myself, annoying my mum and dad, and making the ornaments shake on people's mantelpieces, you know, making the windows rattle. First time I've played with a group this time, the Lurkers, and it's really good. Better than all this stuff.
What have you done before you become a musician?
Worked as a storeman, gardener, packer in a factory, French polisher, newspaper boy. I was 10. I used to sell hot dogs at race meetings. I left school 5 years now, and I've been on the dole for about 3 years of that, haven't I?
Off and on.
Off and on for about 3 years out of five, unemployed. Out of choice, mainly. Boomtown Rats. Useless. Not as good as the Lurkers. They are. Big record company behind them, putting all money into it. That's the only way you get a lot of fame. Corrupt. Sold out.
Do you think you may be corrupt too by the business sometime?
We haven't had the chance to be. No one's offered us any money. We've got managers, but they've got nothing. It's hard enough to get a packet of strings out of them, a set of strings, let alone £100,000 advance to live in luxury. To live in this place, right up in the sky, talking to the birds as they fly past the windows.
Now, question to the parents: what do you think about punk rock and your son now as a musician?
Well, I'm glad he's got on a bit, yeah. Because before,
he's doing something he likes.
Right, yeah.
I've always been aimless, haven't I?
Yeah, drifting about.
Never done anything until I was in a group.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen a concert of the Lurkers?
No.
Come with earplugs on.
I've heard his record, though. Where's the record with you? It's all right. It's better than some of them, isn't it?
Yeah.
My mum said it's as good as anything the Rolling Stones have ever done, didn't you? Didn't you, Mum? It's better, though. They've had it. Got to America. They're not in English anymore. They're not in British. Sold out.
And it's called Shadow. They might be next. Hold up.
Thank you.
down that one. Turn the fans on, man. Off to the spot.
Das Red Cow in Hammersmith, wo die Lurkers spielten, ist weniger modisch als die Clubs der Innenstadt, dafür ist die Stimmung besser. Viele Bands haben hier angefangen, mittlerweile ist das Schild Free Admission, aber auch schon durch Live-Music ausgetauscht worden. Vor den Lurkers sprang unangekündigt eine Band auf die Bühne, die meinte, Punk hieß, nicht spielen zu können. Zu den Schaltstellen im Punkbiz gehört das Büro von Miles Copland. Von hier managt er viele Gruppen und Plattenlabels und vertreibt Sniff & Glue, das wichtigste Punk-Magazin.
What do you charge an ad?
£50 for full page.
How much?
£50 for full page.
Yeah, what's the circulation?
5,000 this last time.
Do you have anybody selling it here?
Yeah, me.
Because you might ought to talk to Harry, because, you know, I mean, he's selling all the glues. Maybe he'd be interested in helping distribute it.
Yes, it would be nice. I'll have to talk to him.
But he's already got a setup for it. I mean, that's a lot of people coming to us because we've already established a distribution network. And to slot something else in doesn't add any more cost to us and saves other people a lot of money. So, I mean, Sniffy Glue is up to 10,000 circulation now. And if they're shipping that kind of stuff out, if you have another magazine, I'm sure he'd be interested in doing something.
Well, you'll have to introduce me.
Yeah, he's here. You know. Hey, Harry! Well, I got rather bored of the things that were going on, and I had some of the people in the office were telling me that things were going on in the clubs and wanted to come down and see what's happening, and which I did, and I spent time out in the clubs, and see all the new groups, and the Roxy Club was in the beginning then. And I was very excited about it. Most of the groups I've been dealing with were groups at which were getting over 30 years old, almost 40. They had kids. It was very difficult to work with them because you'd start having success and they wouldn't be able to follow through because of their home life. For instance, the Climax Blues Band. We had a single which became a very big single in England, but very big in America. I had TV shows booked in Europe. They wouldn't go because they had something to do with their families, which is fair enough, but it means it's very frustrating for somebody dealing with older people. They don't work very hard, and so when you see the young kids and the energy that is being expressed by these kids, also the political aspect of it to me was very exciting. I've always been interested in the politics, and these kids are actually reacting to the society, which to me is far more important. There are two places right now that are interesting musically. Right now, that is New York City and London. London is twice as exciting right now musically as is New York. Maybe it's because the economic situation in England is more aggravated. It creates more ferment in the society. I don't know, but London is a very, very exciting place musically at the moment, and it's much easier for a group to get a start here. In New York, there are very few clubs that a group can play in. There's CBGBs, there's Max's, and one or two others. In London, there's 20, 30 clubs. All over the country, there's more clubs. So it's easier for a group to get in front of the people.
I know you don't like folk music. By the way, I'm wearing a pair of Joan Baez's dirty panties. She wore them at the 1964 Newport Folk Festival. I was a big fan of hers back then, you know. I was only three years old. I didn't know no better, you know. She's okay. This song, this is for all you jerk-offs in the audience. Ooh, look at the wankers. This is called You Make Me Cream in My Jeans.
Die Killjoys fielen uns leider zu spät im Vorprogramm der Electric Chairs auf. Wir besuchten sie am nächsten Tag zur Probe im Greyhound in Fulham nach der mittäglichen Striptease-Show.
fatty one out of old crowd. You don't know what the fuck you're talking about. The press sound in London cause you scream and shout. I think you know what I'm on about. It could be me. Have a little fight. I try going home to your mum and dad. It could be me. It could be me. It could be me. It could be me. It could be me.
Yeah, well, we're the Killjoys, as you know, from Birmingham. We formed about a year ago in Birmingham through adverts in the papers, and we knew some of each other. And we would make it a lot quicker had we had come from London, but Birmingham is 120 miles away, so it's obviously not what London is. But things are starting to go all right for us now. You know, we've got a lot of people interested. We're going down well wherever we go, and we're accepted now in London, whereas we used to just play in Birmingham before.
Can you please tell me something about the punk scene in Birmingham?
Started off really laid back at first. There were only a few to begin with, and it's taken quite a long time to catch on in the initial stages. But John Tully and Barb Rellers have done a lot to promote punk in Birmingham.
London is where it comes from, though. Really, I mean, Birmingham's behind. There's no doubt about it. Birmingham is this, London is the centre of punk. You know, it's the centre of the music world, and Birmingham. Birmingham people just do what London people tell them to do. If it comes from London and it's punk, they think it's good, whether it's good or not. They just do what London tells them to do.
Sit down and sort of talk about things. You can't do that in most other shops. Most other shops, they want you to come in and like buy a record and go out or buy whatever they're selling. And they just want to get rid of you, you know, because there's no interest in anybody talking or doing anything. That's why people come in and read the magazines and do things like that.
It was obvious that this shop would know about punk music from the beginning because people that work in this shop spend their time going to gigs. And if you go to gigs, you know what's going on because people tell you what's good. If you've got ears to listen, you go along and see what's happening. I mean, that's the only reason why this shop was at the start of the new wave, because everyone here was involved in it. I mean, And as soon as we first heard the music, we knew that this was the kind of music we'd been waiting for a long time. I mean, people come in to buy records and their attitude would be, well, I must get a new sound for this week. They get a piece of oral wallpaper and they take it home and they sit in their rooms and listen to it. Well, all that changed when people realised that there was a record that they really wanted to hear, not because it would make them sit down and forget about the world, but because it would make them get up and do something about the world, or at least feel good enough to go out and be on the street, and that was a change. Mm. It's just a matter of us realising that something was going on. And that whole Mr. Jones syndrome, you know, something is happening.
But now it's getting bad because, like, people are coming and just buying every record without even thinking about it, and not listening about it.
Just because it's punk or something like that.
You've got certain groups who just buy it straight off every time.
It's just become a trendy thing now, isn't it? It's all punk, it's just a trend.
Fashion.
Yeah, it's just a
fad. Well, they're still, I mean, they're obviously optimistic about something.
Oh, yeah.
It's like
platform
and, like, with people getting in, like people getting into reggae and stuff like that, because that's exciting music and it's interesting.
Because the major record companies don't think that it's a mass market record, and having made that decision, they're not interested in making those records available to the public. And if they're not available, people can't buy them. And given the fact that the music is made by black people, and there's a tremendous amount of racialism amongst white people in their attitude towards black, that also plays a part in it. But I mean, we feel really excited because boundaries are beginning to be broken down. Mm. We're finding that a lot of shops around the country are interested. In Germany too, I mean, we send records to a shop in Berlin.
Oh, right. I'll pick their body bag and you all want to fucking get on a good hiding, right? Because here comes the adverts, right?
Something heavy is
In Camden, auf einem abbruchreifen Lagergelände der British Railways, ist der Probenraum Rehearsals Rehearsal der Clash. Er steht vielen neuen Bands zur Verfügung, im Moment Subway Sect.
Sort of words
words that you usually get in rock records. They sort of take, I write, say, an essay or something like that, and from that condense the words for a song. So it doesn't end up being sort of normal rock song, hopefully. It's formed about a year ago, exactly. And since then we've sort of been playing with different drummers. I'm playing with one drummer and then stopping for about 3 months. Because we've never had one drummer that we liked.
Why don't you play punk rock?
I don't really think we do. Exactly. We don't play what everyone thinks is punk rock. We're more like sort of Buddy Holly, I reckon.
Auf demselben Gelände, über dem Übungsraum, wohnt Rodent. Rody und quasi fünfter Mann von Clash.
Oh yeah, Light of All Bollocks. That's where we were. Light of All Bollocks. That's what all the new bands are. Nearly all of them copy the Sex Pistols or the Clash. How often we're jumping on the bandwagon. They're a load of crap. There's a couple of good ones. The Slits. Interview with them. Singer's German. Can speak to her. There's this group downstairs, Subway Sex, they're okay, they're a bit different. But most of them are all like the same. They're all, you just get bored watching them. It's like when it started, we wanted lots of different sorts of groups, not lots of groups all trying to copy each other. That's why like Clash and the Sex Pistols, the only two like of the old ones that were any good. All the rest sort of just copied.
What do you think about reggae music?
About what?
Reggae music.
Oh, Richie.
I've seen it.
Green for the land, yellow for the sun that gives life to the land, red for the blood that was spilt for the land. It's great. Love it. I think. It's good.
A lot of bands are influenced by reggae. What do you think about?
Well, a lot of bands were influenced by the Clash and the Sex Pistols liking reggae. Yeah, a lot of them didn't know what it was until sort of 10 months ago. All they thought reggae was I make da da dee da da. Therefore, it's all Desmond Dekker and things, but it's sort of like lots of them didn't bother with it until recently, when it became fashionable.
So what have you done before you become a roadie of the Clash and the Pistons?
As little as possible. Unemployed most of the time. Didn't work. Didn't like working. Shall I tell them I was in prison? Yes, for insurrectionary activities, expropriation of substances from other people, richer people, stealing, political activities.
That's what the angry brigade man said in court.
Well, the sounds, being a paper that's geared to new music, to rock music, we became aware of the Sex Pistols, who were really the first band to open up the punk rock thing. The music papers, along with everybody else, was tired of the old game, the old music business game, and in consequence got very involved and very interested in punk rock. And sounds was one of the first to really pick up on it and to explore it. And maybe, although this is more a case of the National Press, to exploit it a bit. I mean, the National Press have exploited punk for its sensation value, and the violence really stems from their coverage and the fact that they only really given coverage to the more violent aspects, not to any of the ideals, and certainly not very much to the music at all. They failed to understand the music, and they failed to understand the ideals behind the change, because I guess it affects their readership. Their readership is basically the generation with which the punks are not, disaffectionate. And in some cases, they have encouraged the violence between a non-existent group of Teds. They're not really, there is no real Ted movement as such. That whole movement died out in the 50s. That was when they reached their peak. That was when they were the new young rebels. And it's now just maybe even kids who've got nothing better to do on a Saturday other than go in search of some violence or something that will give them a chance to appear in the papers.
Well, we're Teddy Boys, we like rock and roll because we think there's never been a better music, and we like our style of dress because we think it's the best. I don't like punk rockers, but there'll always be fights between different factions. Let's face it, there's no war, so people have to. It's like, if you like, bulls and herd fighting one another. It's human nature. The people are different. I don't like them. They probably don't like me. So I don't care.
Why don't you like them?
Well, to me, they look effeminate. They don't look like they're going to even be men when they grow up. They look like some sort of third sex. It's weird. It's strange. They look like invaders from another planet or something. Very odd. They just... Well, their whole culture is alien to ours, right? Says it all. And the thing we don't like especially is that they copy some of our styles of dress, like they'll put a drape jacket on, and then they rip it, you know? Stupid! And then they copy bits of our music and try and say it's new, and, you know, it just sounds like rock and roll played very badly to me. There's more and more Teddy Boys all the time. They just want to be different. They don't want to be like everybody else. And I think a lot of them, their parents were Teddy Boys. And they start talking about to their fathers, and they tell them how they used to get the clothes made and everything. And they want to be like their fathers, I think, maybe. It's 20 years ago. These guys will have children. The old Teddy Boys had children. I think these are a lot of the children.
We've been around a lot longer than anything else, any other form of dress or anything. And they've come along, they're saying, oh, we're white Teds out, and we'll have punks everywhere. This Johnny Rotten, this The Jam, and all this shit, you know. And they're trying to put it across the country, starting in Britain. But we're not having it. That is why we give them a good hiding every time we meet them.
They just take them off the street.
They can have their global village and all the places they go to. But when they start coming round this area and all these well-known church pubs, they get a good hiding. And that is us.
They're going to wear drapes because they tend to shock. They reckon it shocks people.
They're taking a Mickey piss.
They reckon they wear the drapes because it shocks people.
No way. They're taking a Mickey out of our music.
If they shock people, right? Why do people don't even see us when we walk down the road? So they go on the dustbin liners, stupidly coloured hair. Why bother? There's no point in bothering. It makes them look silly little boys and girls, which they are.
They rip drapes up,
don't
they? They rip them up. They got old creepers on, and their socks, earrings, short hair. It all stems a bit of skin, a bit of Ted. They take the piss all the time. So everyone I see, bus, along the road, in the swimming bars, I'll give him a good eye. Then he's got a bit of red in his hair, blood.
Yeah, right.
They call it music.
Right.
They call it music.
What do they call it? They call it dance. They reckon dancing is jumping up and down like they're on a pogo stick. Is that dancing? No, it ain't. What energy can you burn up through that?
And he had a dog collar on with a dog's chain around his neck and a little bit of leather where you hold onto the dog light at the end. And he had tickets all stuck over him with safety pins. And he just had all his shirts ripped, everything. And there's nothing good about that, is there? They look idiots. Take Mickey all the time.
They basically started it by saying, they're going to wipe Ted's out. Ted's live in the past. All right, fair enough, the style lives in the past. But Ted's lived for today. The music today, rock and roll still lives and always shall live. It started way back, 1940s? Something like that. Fats Domino's very first record. Something about 47, 48, something like that. Okay, it's been going from then, and it's going today, and it'll be going tomorrow, 20 years hence. Right, punk rockers come along and say, okay, we're clever, we're big, we've got music. They may call it music, but it's not. They said they was going to wipe Ted's out.
No way.
That's why they get hiding. They get themselves beaten up because they reckon they're bigger than us.
The fights between Ted's and punks, it's not a new thing in a way, really, because you still have the fights with the mods and the rockers, and the skinheads and the Pakis, Pakistanis. So, in general, the youth of any generation, if there's not a war, they like to use their aggression up some way at football matches and things like that. So they've got an ideal thing to have a go at, which is a punk, from Ted's point of view anyway. It's very difficult to sort of say that they just like fighting for the sake of fighting, but they feel as though they've got to use their energy on something.
Im angesehenen 100 Club nehmen die Jam, die sauberste Punkband, mit großem technischen Aufwand ihre erste Live-LP für Polydor auf. Alle ihre Konzerte sind ausverkauft, auch wenn der Saal doppelt so groß ist wie der hier.
For what they want. The street that was a part of the British monarchy. British monarchy. Who wants seconds and all that? We don't need them now. But why should we accept the change of mind? Because of today. Kids, 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 we're gonna change and bring back the street. Shops filled by old nation. Cannabis Street. Cannabis Street. Cannabis Street. The street is a mirror for our country. Reflects the rise and fall of our nation.
Nation!
The street that was a legend is a mockery, a part of the British tradition. Come down the train, you don't need no passport to see its faults. Take a walk along that street again, see what I mean. Calabi Street, Calabi Street. Cannabis Street, not what it used to be. Cannabis Street, not what it used to be. Cannabis Street, bells to dust are gone. Cannabis Street, bells to dust are gone. Cannabis Street, oh, oh, oh. Cannabis Street, oh, 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 oh.
Thank you. Good old story, my brother.
Quite ironic, innit? No problems at Hammersmith. There's a tune you might know.
When we watch them, when we go to town, God, bye.
Die kommerziell erfolgreichste New Wave Band sind die Stranglers. Ihre erste LP war die 8 erfolgreichste des Vorjahres. Die meisten Leute fragen sich jedoch, was die Stranglers außer ihrem Namen mit Punk gemein haben. Wir wollten sie dazu im Haus ihres PR-Managers Alan Edwards befragen, sie weigerten sich jedoch.
Right,
one of those.
Oh,
they're
going to
do it.
Hey, look,
I'm
not on it. Why you don't want to stay in our movie?
Eh? Right, give me a
statement. We want your, only your statement why you don't want to stay in our, want to stay in our movie.
Because I'm no prostitute.
And you don't do...
I don't want to sell any records in Germany. I want German bands to sell them in Germany.
And you hate Germans, you say?
Eh? Majority, yeah.
Simply because we are Germans?
No, because simply because you take and you don't give, you don't, you've got a lot of responsibility to the idea of Europe and you're just taking. I'll play to the people who want to hear us in Germany, but otherwise I couldn't care if that.
But a lot of people in Germany want to hear you and want to know something about...
They're going to hear us next week. They didn't want to hear us 9 months ago. See, I reckon, I'm very suspicious of German motives. I reckon they're just a pose, you know. I don't believe they're genuine. Until they prove themselves, then we don't want to know, you know.
I don't understand your argument because...
No, you never do.
I think punk now is a joke, actually. I don't think it bears any resemblance to what it started out as, and I don't think it's fulfilled very many of its original aims in England anyway. I mean, it's been turned into a commercial carnival so quickly that the people who started it and people put the original ideas have lost control of what they're doing. Record companies and the music business in general and the media have cashed in on it so quickly, and they've taken everything out of it. They've taken the creativity, the ideas, the imagination out of it, and they've put nothing back except money, and that has actually killed it. I mean, I think the people who are responsible for making punk rock what it is, or making punk rock, never envisaged what has happened now.
Yeah, and they lost out, basically.
Yeah.
I mean, they started the whole thing. It was their ideas, and they've really lost out on all the benefits of it.
The people who put it together were like people like Andrew Sosowski, who opened the Roxy Club, people like that. They've been bought out by bigger concerns, by big companies, record companies. They've ended up with no money, nothing. And punk has been taken out as just another commodity to sell. So in a way, it hasn't achieved any of its ideas. The original idea was to get away from the old music, selling a product.
The original thing for punk was that the kids could identify with it, they could talk. They could go up and talk to the bands. The bands would go to the same places as they would. They could just see the bands all over the place. They weren't stars. But unfortunately it's very difficult because bands have got to get record company contracts, right? I mean, to be able to survive.
And
it's very difficult to see how they could have combined the two, you know, keeping it on the level with the kids and having the money, you know.
There's no way that punk could have stayed, as the Jeff says, there's no way that punk could have stayed as it was. Punk would have had to have evolved and become a big business. It's just unfortunate that it became a big business so quickly.
And it trod on so many people on the way up, that's the problem. You
and know. A lot of the people have proved that once they're successful, they're just as rich and they're just as into being capitalists and they're just as into making money and forget the people who put them there, as was the old generation of the old farts or whatever. So the new wave has quickly become exactly the same as the old wave.
In most cases. And unfortunately, I mean, the punk followers have got into the same thing as these sort of the old hippies, you know, the old farts. As Rotten says, you know, that they only accept their own kind, they're not tolerant to other people, which is what they should be. I mean, the whole thing about anarchy was that, you know, Rotten was saying personal anarchy.
Right.
You don't interfere in anybody else's business, you keep to what you want to do, and that's how you should go. And unfortunately, it hasn't turned out like that. He's the only person that's kept doing it, really.
The whole thing about punk rock was it didn't matter whether you were black, it didn't matter whether you were white, it didn't matter whether... what your hair was, what you looked like, whether you're ugly, rich, poor or pretty. But already there's a snobbery within punk where you've got to have short hair, you've got to have tight trousers, you've got to have plastic clothes or whatever. And already they're as bad as the people with long hair who said that you couldn't be fashionable if you had short hair and this sort of thing. So it's a shame that punk has, it's not fulfilled a lot of its original aims, in a nutshell. And that's it, the cynic's view of punk rock. What next?
Yeah, what next?
Marquis spielen heute die Boomtown Rats. Obwohl an der Tür 700 Leute wieder weggeschickt werden müssen, ist es im Club so heiß und eng, dass der Sänger später auf der Bühne ohnmächtig wird.
Mit den Sex Pistols im letzten Jahr im April, die haben als Vorgruppe zu den Hot Rods gespielt. Und die waren musikalisch sehr, sehr schlecht. Der Sänger konnte nicht singen und der Bassgitarrist hat nur drei Saiten gehabt und der Schlagzeuger war vollkommen besoffen. Ja. Dadurch wollten wir das sehr schlechte Publikum angekommen und wir wollten keinen Punk mehr haben danach. Und über die Zeit, über die nächsten drei, vier Monate, wenn Sommer wieder kam, war es sehr, sehr popular geworden. Durch die neue Mode und die Presse hat es sehr, sehr stark angenommen und viele Leute haben mich gefragt, ob ich nicht Punk buchen könnte und dann habe ich nachgegeben und habe Punk-Gruppen gebucht im letzten Sommer. Das war ein großer Erfolg und seitdem machen wir Punk-Rock.
Was war denn vorher das Hauptsächliche?
Rockgruppen, Hard-Rock, Underground, Hard-Rock-Gruppen.
Und worin unterscheidet sich das Punk-Publikum und die Punk-Gruppen von den anderen Gruppen? Gibt es da Schwierigkeiten mit? Man hört einiges von Gewalt und sowas.
Junge Leute kommen hier, um Musik zu hören. Ob es Punk-Rock ist oder andere Gruppen spielen. Ja. Leute können Musik zu hören im Marquee Club. Die kommen nicht hier, um Schlägereien zu veranstalten oder sich zu betrinken oder was. Nur gute Musik für wenig Geld.
Wie kommt denn das zustande, dass du als Deutscher hier das Marquee leitest, was ja so der wichtigste Laden in London?
Als ich noch in Deutschland war, ich vom Marquee gehört und bin nachher nach England gegangen. Als ich in London war, bin ich zum Marquee gekommen und mir Gruppen angesehen und mir gefiel das hier. Und dann habe ich gefragt, ob irgendwelche Jobs hier gehen. Und da habe ich in der Garderobe angefangen zu arbeiten und hart gearbeitet, 12, 14 Stunden am Tag und langsam mich hochgearbeitet. Nach 3 Jahren buche ich die Gruppen hier und manage den Club.
Meinst du, dass Punk noch eine Zukunft hat und das ist in nächster Zeit?
Punk hat eine große Zukunft. Denn alle Schallplattenfirmen in London sind sehr, sehr stark daran interessiert. Und es verkauft sich sehr gut, weil was Neues ist, was Verschiedenes, was anderes ist, mit ihrer Mode. Und es ist neu für junge Leute, ja, die haben keine Lust mehr, in Konzerte zu gehen und sich Gruppen wie Yes oder Genesis anzuhören, weil es zu kompliziert ist. Punk ist einfache, harte Musik, ja, harter Rock, der sehr, sehr schnell gespielt wird, wo sich amüsieren können und mitmachen können.
Und was hältst du persönlich von Punk?
Geschäftlich gesehen ist der sehr gut für uns, aber persönlich, also Musik, ich gebe nach Hause und höre mir die Eagles an.
It's like, you just go down somewhere like the Vortex and that, and you listen to half the groups and you see how boring they are, and you find out that most people would be put to sleep by it all. Yeah. It's just a couple of good bands, and that's it. They'll go and make a lot of money. And make a lot of music, and the rest will fade away and die. All the high-blown ideals disappeared years ago. That shocked you. You didn't expect that.
They become very watered down.
Yeah. You're going to Germany the next month. Do you have any idea about Germany? Yeah, they're all rich in Germany. Lots of Deutschmarks, apart from these three. Yeah, no, don't know. I only know about the only things I'll bother reading about Germany, about the RAF. Because they're interesting, but reading about Willy Brandt and Chancellor Schmidt or whoever they all are is boring, so. Very efficient country, we're told. Very efficient.
And he met me,
People ask us this question all the time, you know.
I'd say 18 months.
18 months, right? You nick my fucking bag again. Hey, London, come on.
Essen.
It's a bit of dream.
We haven't eaten since we've been here. We've been here 3 days. We haven't had a thing to eat yet.
You don't want people.
Thank you.
lot of trouble in Germany.
Yeah, it's fucking horrible. I never want to come back here again. It stinks.
I do, though.
Unless we're at war.
It's great. So far.
What do you think of the German bird?
I've been in hotels and it's been really horrible. People, a lot of older people have been very sort of like nasty to us. They're not sort of helping us at all. But it's the young people who are great. Great, like the concert tonight.
They froze the fucking slammer. They ain't got a fucking hotel for us. The gigs are fucking useless.
We ain't got a hotel. We got the police came round, dragged us out from the hotel. You know, I mean, we really want to like Germany. Yeah. Well, I do anyway. I think it looks great.
Like a bomb.